So, in the first half of this presentation, we spoke a lot about the problems, okay?
The challenges that we all face.
And I don't know whether it's a nice thing or a bad thing that it seems like you have faced the same challenges here, but whatever, it seems that's the case. This half, we're going to talk about some theories, some solutions. The way that we've done this work that has actually worked and achieved the results. Okay? So we're going to start off by presenting two theories. We're going to talk a bit about some of the successes that we've had. I'm going to show you a nice video of some of the work that we've done as well. And then we're going to go through and we're going to talk about how you actually show the outcomes to your funders or to adults, young people, communities. So the first model we have here is a model that works on looking at the need. Okay? And yes, we're focusing on the substances here. Okay? And it's a model that is currently the model in the UK, if you like. So the idea here is that you match the kind of service that you're delivering to the appropriate need. Okay? And they group these needs into three tiers. Okay? Tier one being general youth population. So here we're talking about everybody. Okay? This is everybody. Tier two, those young people that are at risk. Okay? So they're borderline. They're the ones that are going to get themselves into trouble. Okay? Or end up there. And tier three, those with the absolutely acute needs. Okay? So if you imagine the way this gets represented, it's like a pyramid. Okay? With the most people at the bottom of the pyramid being tier one, mass population. Those in the middle, smaller group, those individuals that are using, that maybe end up there. And tier three, those with the acute needs. So let's look at tier one. So what do we need to do with tier one? What are the needs here for tier one? Well, we need to make sure, as we said before, that we give them truthful, honest, non-biased information. Okay? So we want to give individuals, everybody, the information that is both positive and negative, long-term, short-term effects, the truth about drugs, okay? And as Colin said before, drugs speak for themselves, okay? I've lectured on many occasions around substances, sometimes spent a whole week just on one drug. And we're actually talking more about the courses that we run a bit later, but it's amazing how many people come out of those lectures, those courses, feeling quite negative about drugs, or that particular drug, because drugs speak for themselves, okay? So, we need to make sure that the services are credible and all those things that we mentioned before. But there's something important about this group of individuals. And what we realised was it's more important that they have the information available to them so they can make their own choice, that it was just to bombard everybody with all the information that they need to know about drugs. Okay? And the other the biggest indicator we found was we also needed to make sure that they had an idea of where to go if they needed that information or that support. So, what we did was we created signpost paraphernalias. Right? Leaflets that just had snippets of information that were designed in such a way that these young people, I mean, I guarantee you, these cards, we had sets of cards printed up, okay? 15 in total. One was just about our organisation, the others were, and one was about sexual health, you know, safe sex. And the others were about the main drugs. And these cards became so popular that young people were putting them on their bedroom walls. Other rival agencies were buying cards. Okay? Now the information on those cards wasn't that much, really. It was just a main harm reduction advice around those drugs and the names and some indicators. But the important thing was that it was done in such a way that it felt part of their community and their group, their youth culture. Why was it? Why did it feel so much a part of that youth culture? Because it was designed by them. We took artists from the community, graphic designers from the community. We consulted, you know, people that worked on that team were the rave promoters. So it was done in the style of the rave flyers. Even today, how many years on?
10.
10 years on. 10 years on. We've updated the information twice, and we haven't really updated the information that much, some language. And it's still the most popular piece of paraphernalia in the UK. Okay? Now this, I would say, is fantastic. Looks nice. But this is so much information, you're never going to get a young person that puts this on their bedroom wall. Yeah? So, with this group, we're aiming here to just signpost, give them something that if they ever, you know, get in trouble with drugs, they ever move on to the next group, they know what to do. There was also some other programs we did. I'll speak a little bit more about the peer education program. We took young people like myself from the street, and we went into every single school in the London boroughs and the localities that we worked in. And when we went into the schools, because of confidentiality, the teachers went out of the room. I spoke to a teacher, I can't see the guy now. Someone was a teacher in the break. Who did this with? Fantastic. So I don't know what it's like in Norway, but in the UK, a teacher cannot provide confidentiality. Okay? There's a limit to how much confidentiality a teacher can provide in the UK. So if certain things are said within the room, then a teacher must act upon it. And maybe sometimes the teacher can't know every single subject on the planet. Sometimes the teacher's not the best person to know about that subject. So it actually puts the teacher in a compromising position. So when our professionals went in to the class, the teachers left the room. Straight away, the 30 young people in the room felt at ease and felt that they could actually ask the truthful questions that they wanted to ask. And not say, well, I have a friend that knows a friend that maybe sometimes their guns bleed when they take speed, amphetamines. Why is this, you know? So we had a much more honest environment. And this was some of the reason why we reduced the national average for drug use in the most deprived area of the UK. We reduced it by just under half. Yeah, amazing. I'm going to pat myself on the back and call it publicly, right now. And there were some other amazing pieces of work. What we haven't spoke about, we've spoken a lot about schools at the moment and the education kind of environment. But we want to make sure that these young people are safe. Where's the best place to make sure that they're safe? When they're most in danger. When they're most in danger. Actually at the rates that they're going to. So what did we do? We arranged for the biggest rave promoters in the UK to go to the biggest events and take teams of at-risk staff that we trained up especially. We worked with the ambulance services, okay? And we went around the raves giving out water to people that were actually eating. Okay? And if you give water to someone that's eating, they're very grateful, let's just say that. Yeah? We were spraying them. We're giving them advice, counselling, on-site, at the raves. In fact, the work became so successful that the government in the UK changed its philosophy on licensing for raves. They made compulsory that all raves or venues, the staff had to have training about drugs, and they're passing, they're actually changing the law even in pubs and clubs at the moment in the UK. All out of this work. Back in 92. But there are some challenges. Okay? And the challenges are, Mr. Cripps.
You go and talk, get kids talking openly about drugs in a school, and suddenly the school becomes aware that it's got a drug problem. You go and get people talking openly and honestly about what goes on in raves, and suddenly the raves are seen as a problem, and the promoters might not want you. Actually, just giving the information can be misinterpreted as being dangerous. If you're saying to someone, this is how you take something more safely, a lot of people would say you're encouraging them to use it. Now, all the evidence, and it's been researched and researched and researched, is that that is not what happens. You tell someone how to use drugs more safely, all that happens is people use drugs more safely. Other people don't suddenly start to use it. Like I said before, you know, one person's harm reduction is another person's abstinence. Tier two, if you're looking at need, you're looking at those at risk. In the UK, the definition of those at risk is those who are in touch with the criminal justice system, with social services, or with educational welfare. That's not my definition of those at risk. That's my definition of those who got caught. The ones who are too clever to get caught are the ones who are really at risk, because no one is in touch with them at all. They're the ones who are really vulnerable. How are you going to get them to come to the services that they need? You can only do that through outreach. You can only do that, in my argument, you can only do that through peer-led outreach. And you can only do that if what they're coming to isn't something that says, come here and we'll deal with your problems. What it has to say to those people, kids who know not to go anywhere near the authorities, what you've got to say is, come here, because coming here is going to be wicked. Coming here is going to be the lick. This is going to be the best thing that you ever did. How do you make a drug service like that? I mean, you know, come here and we'll prescribe for you. We'll give you acupuncture. We'll, you know, no use. So what we're trying to do is make our services part of youth culture. And they don't just do drugs work. For example, we run DJ and MC workshops. We run a computer music training program. Now, I go into our project in Thamesmead. Most evenings, there's 50 kids from the Black Street Gangs in there, headphones on, silence, creating the backing tunes for the raps on computers. Failed information technology at school, failed computer classes at school, in fact, barely went to school. Here they are doing complicated jobs on a computer. Why? Because it's fun. So we're tackling their learning issues at the same time as we're tackling their drugs issues, and none of it looks like tackling issues. It all feels like fun. If you think back to the way that kids learn in the first few years of life, they don't do it the way they learn at school. They do it by just playing around with things and finding out. They learn through play. And what we try and do is make our services somewhere where people can go play in an adult way. We've had dance troupes, graffiti projects. We'll show you a bit in a second. We've got our own record label. We haven't had any number ones yet. But we have had some dance floor hits. All the music made by young people. And we do chill-out work in clubs and festivals. That's the way you get young people at risk to use services. You get into what is the outlaw gang philosophy, what is it that they're into, you get into it too. How do you do that? You get the DJs to work with you. You find the new talent in the community. You take that plan next year is to have our own website selling the music of the young people who come to the services. Online. And the young people are helping to set that up. We're going to have our own broadband radio station. The young people are helping to set that up. And we get hundreds of kids. We don't have to go out there and go, where's the kids with the problems? They just walk through the door. The challenge there is of raising expectations and then letting people down. Because what we do find is that people are prepared to fund this work as a nice little frippery one-off. Oh, they want to start a radio station. Okay, well, we'll give them a little bit of money and then they'll have to find their own. The challenge for us is, okay, now we've got a little bit of money and we've started it, where are we going to get more money to keep this stuff going? Well, how about the music industry? How about Sony? How about some of the big corporates? How about Nike? How about getting the agencies that sell to youth, putting some money back into things that help you? So that's our challenge for next year, is trying to get into the private sector, into the commercial part of it all, so that we're not setting up things that we're going to let young people down in a year or two down the road. The other challenge is to delegate responsibility and control of that agenda. When people say, make these young people services, what they really mean is ask them what they want, but don't give them control of the money. Because young people aren't responsible enough to handle the money. We haven't got over that yet. Because we would do it, but the people who give us the money won't let that happen. We actually think they'd spend it quite responsibly. I mean, we're not saying that we'd just let them do it on anything, but we think that they need to be involved in that. And then again, the fear of controversy. Oh, you know, and that, and the other one is, you're rewarding them for bad behaviour. Rewarding them for bad behaviour. Bad kids, give them a present. No, it isn't like that. What you're doing, and let me just give you one example. In January this year, for 3 months, we worked with the 15 worst offenders in the East End of London, the 15 worst criminals under the age of 18. We had them for 4 days a week in this kind of program. By the end of the 3 months, 13 of them were in employment or in further education. Not one of the 15 had re-offended. One, unfortunately, in the meantime, for offences committed beforehand, had gone to prison. Now, that is a good result. We went back to the authorities and said, give us money for a follow-up, and they went, yeah, well, later on, maybe. I haven't funded it yet, but we'll send you across the report on that, on how well that worked. But it worked. It worked again. Is it the video? Let's just show you a couple of little bits of the stuff we've done. What you'll see on here is you'll see some of the DJ and MC work we did, some of the radio station work we did, and a graffiti project that we did at Heathrow Airport. We've done graffiti murals for British Rail or Rail Track, for Heathrow Airport, for some shops in South London, loads of things like that. Let's just play it. Thank you. you'll have noticed throughout that, those black and white faces, that logo. The aim, as far as we're concerned, is to make that logo as credible in youth culture as the Nike logo. Is to market information, to market services in the way that the private sector does, because that's what young people are used to. They're used to people selling to them and putting a lot of effort into selling to them, and to doing that in a glossy, high-tech, fun way. If we don't compete with that, we lose. We lose them.
It's my song.
Okay, mate.
And a couple of things to say about the video. Firstly, we took that in Heathrow, in Hillingdon Borough, where Heathrow Airport is, those of you that travel to London, very likely to have flown into Heathrow. They call it the gateway to the world. It's the biggest, busiest airport in the world. In that borough, they had a huge problem with graffiti. We're seeing some graffiti on the way here. Do you have a problem with graffiti here? No?
Not like we do.
No, not like we. And basically, the graffiti artists were also labelled as criminals and various other things. So for us, we come back to one of our biggest philosophies, our biggest principles of our work. And that is that if you can take this negative energy over here, and instead of trying to ignore it or fix it, if you can change that negative energy into positive, then you've got something real to work with. Speak to any person in physics and they will tell you that energy cannot be destroyed. Okay? It can only be changed from positive to negative. Now, more visitors to Heathrow Airport, more people see this artwork at London Heathrow than visitors to the UK National Gallery every year. More people. You'll notice from the video that the young people in that video, what do?
They're sad.
No, they're smiling. Yeah? Got time, yeah, I've been told about time. Okay, so it's about turning that into positive energy, it's about making a difference, it's about taking something that exists in the youth culture and including that in your service in a positive way.
Okay, I'm not going to say much about the tier three. We all know what people who need to get in the ambulance need. They need treatment. And we provide all of that as well. We provide the high-end treatment. We've got crack outreach teams going into crack houses. You know, at the raves and festivals, we could call the ambulance. We'd be doing the first aid with people on the floor. And there are challenges and risks with that kind of outreach work with peer educators. And those are the risks and the dangers for the workers going into those kind of areas. But they're a lot safer coming from those areas. And the other danger, I suppose, is that you're asking people to make life and death calls. But there's another way of looking at this, another philosophy. And I'm not going to repeat a lot, but I'm just going to put it in a different framework. If you look at the way that we are, as the stemming from the values that we have, growing through the beliefs that we have into the behaviour that we exhibit, and that what this is all really about is about how we see ourselves and about how young people see themselves, and particularly young people who, in that stage of life, identity is the most important thing. Who am I going to be? What am I in life? What you're told about yourself at that age is the most important thing. If you look at that, and you're working with behaviour, then you're actually working with those who are already damaged. Those are those crisis interventions. When it's reached the level of exhibiting itself in destructive behaviour, then you're doing first aid work. You're calling the ambulance. You're attempting, that's what our outreach work is about. We believe that it's much more important to get to work at the level of belief. To take those groups who are at risk and whose lives and beliefs and group norms are leading them onto dangerous life paths, and to hook them into those kind of diversionary activities and work with those belief systems, but reframe them. Make them mean something different. Because the real battleground is not about how much money there is for services, it's about meaning, it's about It's about ideas. It's about a vision of what young people are. It's about turning me, I'm a problem, into me, I'm potential. Me, I can go somewhere. I always say to young people when I first meet, well, I don't, not that I meet them anymore, but what I used to do when I used to meet them was, I don't want to hear about your past. I don't care. You came through the door. I'm not interested where you were. Where do you want to go? Who do you want to be? How can we get you there? So that kind of diversionary activity, at the same time as attracting people in, gives them the skills. When they're learning the computer music, they're learning computing skills. When they're learning the DJ and MC stuff, they're learning socialization skills. They're mixing with other people, they're mixing with staff, they're getting a sense of a different set of values and different set of norms other than the negative ones they're used to on the street. The theory of identity is how do we come to perceive ourselves this way? It's the reaction of others. Now you imagine you're a young person with a whole heap of problems. What's the reaction of other people to you? Adults walk the other side of the street because they think you're going to set on them. You're dangerous. You hang around a group corner. In England it's like that. There's a group of kids on the street corner. Better call the police. You know, there's nowhere else for them to go, but we'd better call the police and move them on because they're hanging around. They might assault someone. So the reaction of others is, I'm bad. Comparison with others. You're talking kids who failed school, who failed formal education. Who am I? I'm a failure. I'm bad and I'm a failure. Social roles, they don't have one. I'm a failure, I'm dangerous and I'm an outsider. And identification. Well, you know, the identification quite often is a number on a file somewhere. The focus is on individual problems, and the idea is to find a way of harnessing energy into positive ends, as Danny was saying. And at the end of the day, what it all comes down to is reshaping values, young people's values. Changing how they see themselves, changing how they see their potential, changing how they see their future, changing their social environment. If you draw young people into groups where other young people are working in a positive way, in a record label or whatever, run by young people, you actually change the way they act. You change what they become. They role model themselves in a different way, where the workers become the mom and dad they never had. One of the embarrassing things in the early days of our service, when there was only about four or five of us, was that young people used to call me Pops. I always used to go, no, I'm not your father. But I knew exactly what they meant. Because they didn't have one. So I was the only thing that represented father. And in reality, what we have to do with our staff is to get them to represent what father should be, what mother should be, what brother should be, what sister should be. But they have to fulfill those functions, not in a too close way, not in a way that blurs boundaries, but they have to act in a way that represents the values that a father should have, a mother should have, so that they feel safe and accepted. And the way you turn things into positivity, Danny.
Has anyone heard of life coaching? Yeah. Anyone heard of that? Okay, I can explain it. Okay. Someone wants to play good tennis or be a good swimmer. Who do they go to? Who helps them? Or be a good football team? To have a coach. Yeah. A concept's come out of America that basically that you have a life coach. Someone coaches you on your life. Now, I don't know if it's in Norway, but it certainly is in England, certainly is all over America and Australia. Most of the top people, top actors, top professionals, top businessmen have their own life coach. Okay? Why have a life coach? Well, to talk about that, I want to give you just a really brief explanation of some research that happened in the United States. One of the major universities in the States, Yale University, they carried out one of the biggest surveys of students. And what they did was they just asked the students where they thought they was going to be in 10, 15 years' time. okay? And I got their current, you know, family situation. So how much money they had, where they lived in, you know, just generally what their statistics were. And they went back to that same, they found every single student from that university 20 years later. Okay? And they found out what they were doing, what jobs they had, how much money they had, whether they had family, cars, houses, and whatever. And when they realised that 4% of the whole had more wealth, okay, now I'm not just talking about financial wealth here, I'm talking about family, house, car, the whole works, 4% had more than all the other 96% put together. 4% had more than all the other 96% put together. So they started investigating why. And they realised there was one common thing that these these 4% of people did. They ripped down their goals. That's all. They ripped down their goals. They had goals to achieve. So what we've been doing is we've been taking that model working that usually the top businessmen, MPs, ministers, the top high society would get. We've been using them same individuals to coach the young people, okay, in their lives. What if those young people on the street had goals and expectations and dreams? Okay? So ultimately, coaching is a vehicle, a way of working with a person to get them to fulfill their dreams. Okay? So a coach, it's been labelled similar to counselling and therapy, but the difference with coaching is it's always about now and the future. So how are you going to do that? Let's concentrate on the future by asking questions to make sure that young people get to their goal. What do they want to achieve is a good question. What person do they want to be? Yeah? So it's about forward, positive thinking.
Okay. So, what's the first step that you can take today to change, to get where you want to go? And the philosophy is that you can only achieve quantum improvements in life if you quit hacking at the leaves of attitude and behaviour and get to work on the root from which all of it flows. Get down to that thing about values at the bottom and start changing those. We're going to have to give some up, and I don't know what we're going to give up, man.
We've got 10 minutes.
Okay, real quick, let's try and talk real quick, but real clear, so that they're just on the level of understanding what we're saying and get through. Okay.
Can we swap sides? Maybe,
okay.
Maybe this is a quick side, that's a slow side. Okay, so. Fantastic, we're all doing really well. You know, we're running these services, we're delivering this education, we're going to the raves, we're working with the users, we're bringing in the real hard to reach individuals into the service. But how can we make sure that our staff are being professional enough to really work with young people appropriately? How can we make sure? Where's the quality control? And I always, you know, I did a speech about this about 6 years ago, 7 years ago in England. And I was saying that if you want to be a probation officer or a police officer or a fireman or a police officer or whatever, teacher, you have to go through some formal training. There's some professional standards that you have to adhere to. In a drugs field, there's none. Okay? Anyone and their dog can be a drugs worker. Okay? In the UK. So what we had to do was we had to think of a way to address this problem. Yeah? So we looked at using training. We run 6-month training programs with every individual that comes in the staff. And we're not just talking about sending them off to university or college. No, we're running the training program in the drug service. Okay? So we're not just talking about young people receiving training, we're talking about apprentices here. We're talking about young people that now knows what the other end of the problem's like, because they walk out of the room where they've just learnt about heroin, and they walk into the waiting room where they're seeing the heroin user pick up their methadone. Okay? Very, very effective formal training. But the training did something else as well. This 6 month training program that I'm talking about, and it was nationally accredited too. We found something very interesting. We found that the individuals that went on that program that were using drugs at the start were not using drugs at the end. Okay, and you think, well, that's all well and good. Fantastic. But what we found was it was more successful than any treatment program in the UK. Okay? So I'm talking about the people that go, you know, high-end, you know, therapists. More successful. More people were abstaining from drug use at the end of this program than anything else. Now, there's something very important about taking a group of individuals with common values, common sense of purpose, from a common background, and using those individuals and taking them through a 6 month program. Now in the UK, finally it's got to a stage where we're actually designing occupational standards for drugs workers. Where drug workers actually, just like probation officers or police officers, have to obtain a qualification. However, thankfully, it's not just going to university and learning something academic. Okay? Because I'm telling you this now. You can have all the academic experience you want in the world. If you haven't got that experience from the street, and the language, and you know truly how to engage with young people on that level, you will not get through. You will not work. You will not be successful. I've seen it time and time again. So here, we've got a win-win situation. Because we found a way of addressing and working with young people, and we also found a way of getting those young people that were most hard to reach, giving them qualifications and jobs at the end of it. Okay? So, the cycle's fulfilled. The young people that come from the street, that went into the service, got trained, went back and educated those individuals that brought other young people on board. So we have a circle of life. Is that enough?
That's cool. No, not that enough. I'm missing that one. I haven't got time for that.
And that one.
Yeah, because everyone does. And we'll miss that as well.
There you go.
How do you show that this stuff is worth putting money into? And just as I say, we've had our setbacks and we lose services, we've gained more than we've lost. And you're in a world where money comes with figures. How many people did you see? How many did you put through the system? What I want to know is, you know, how many of them were offenders? How many of them are offending now? How many? And what we're talking about is actually changing people. Okay? So, to us, outcomes are about positive improvements in circumstances and prospects. That's not in the national drugs measures in the UK. These things are not in the measures. But to us, they're the essential things. The second thing is that those outcomes have got to be self-recognised. People have got to feel that they've got better. They've got to have their own understanding that things have improved for them. And they've got to be able to stand up and say, I'm telling you that I've got better as a result of this. That I'm now more the person that I want to be. And not just obtainable, but sustainable. A number of times, actually got told by someone from government, like about 3 months ago, he said, we don't care if they're out the door 1 minute and 6 months later they're back through the door. That's an extra statistic. That's criminal. That's not an extra statistic. That's someone's life screwed. I don't want a revolving door where they go out, you know, we've got you off drugs, go out into a shit life that you were in before, walk round the block and come back in the other door again. No, not good enough. It's got to be a sustainable thing. So you actually have to change lives and be able to measure that you've changed lives. Now, in the UK, you're supposed to be able to measure emotional well-being, physical and mental health, drug using or offending behaviour, social well-being. But as far as we're concerned, the most important one is that last one. It's personal growth. It's an improved process of thinking. The reason the training is so effective is that we actually encourage people to ask questions about life all the time. not to accept what's going on. One of the earlier slides was going to say, there's a big problem. We're putting, with it saying, you're the mistake, and we're going to put you back into a society, and you'll fix society is right. Well, sometimes society isn't right. Sometimes it's society that's wrong. So we can't just put you back to fit neatly into a hole and become some passive, I don't know, zombie. We want someone out there who's going to question what's going on, who's going to be able to make a change in life, who's going to be able to make a change in society. So what we're looking for is an improved process of thinking. People who don't just go, it says in the papers, people who go, I'm thinking behind that headline. Dad.
Okay, in the UK, things, and I'm sure that you have similar models here, things in terms of outcome, when you have to give your outcomes to the funders and record the ways that you're working, how many people you've seen, you tend to have funders asking for hard outcomes. In other words, how many young people did you see when you went on outreach? How many young people are no longer using heroin? Okay? Statistics, hard outcomes. Okay? They call them hard outcomes. And also, the other set of outcomes are soft outcomes, so the changes in people's attitudes. Okay? Now, someone might, you know, there might be a situation where someone might have changed their beliefs and attitudes, and that is long term. That's going to be a long term change in the individual. Now, soft outcomes are usually just less visible. Okay? Usually just less visible. Like what you see with the graffiti projects and stuff like that. We're achieving soft outcomes then. No funder is going to say, oh, very well done. What actually happened there? You see six young people. Okay? No, we actually changed six young people's life forever. Okay? So, generally, when you're working with a less visible outcomes, you're going to get the most long-term solutions. That's the point here.
So, how do you sell that? And I say sell again, and I keep using sell a lot in this, because so much of it is actually about, it's about marketing. It's about marketing to the people who put up the money. I think what we have to accept is that we've got to do long-term impact analysis. We've got to watch people through 1 year, 2 year, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, and see over a long period of time how people who come into contact with our services have changed. And that means us keeping in contact with them, us following them around. We've got a few nice testimonies at the moment. The current inspector of Her Majesty's Prisons, work in Her Majesty's Prisons, started with us as a client on one of our training programs. Now that's an excellent example of a long-term impact analysis. We know what we did to his life. He can go around and talk about it. He could be a case study. People like to hear stories, illustrating everything with stories, personal testimony. It's getting people to stand up and say, this has changed me. What we're working on now is instead of just giving people a set of statistics in our reports at the end of each quarter, actually giving them a video or a CD-ROM with some of the people on it saying, this is what's happened for me. To try and cut through that bureaucratic numbers game. To get people saying, this is what has changed. Fundamentally, my whole lifestyle has changed. The way that I think and believe about life has changed. Now, I wish I could say, it's all wrapped up, and if you do all of that, this will all become very popular, and government will give you lots of money, and we'll all be able to go out there, and we'll all be able to change the world. And I know that it isn't like that. But what we've come to a conclusion as an agency is that there might be other ways that we could get more money. There might be other approaches to drugs work. We ain't interested in them. This is the only one that we think has the long-term impact. That's all we're interested in doing. We got nothing else to say. It's time for you to ask questions. We have absolutely nothing else to say. Thank you for listening so hard in the heat.
I'll just do something in a week. Jeg vet at det fryktelig varmt her inne, og vi ligger litt bak tiden, men jeg vil be alle om allikevel å legge inn en liten ekstra innsats på spørsmålsrunden nå. Men for at vi skal få litt energi igjen, så vil jeg at alle skal reise seg opp. Og så skal vi bare helt enkelt, bare rett og slett, stille oss litt opp på tå, og så høyre armen opp, og så strekk så langt du kan høyre armen opp. Lengre, lengre, lengre. Lengre, lengre, og så, og så den andre. Og så skal alle gjespe i kor, ok? 1, 2, 3. Ok, så setter vi oss ned i grupper igjen. And I'll do this briefly repeat in English, so they know what's going to happen. You'll now have 5 minutes
to do dialogue around this thing, just work in the groups, and afterwards we have one question.
Everyone is looking at me. How do you like Norway? Okay. That's a nice, easy question to start with. To be honest, I don't know what I expected. I think I expected some mountains and snow and things like that. I mean, really, I'm very surprised. I'm very surprised. I'm very humbled. I'm very happy. I think it's very nice. I feel a bit ashamed by English people having to go to someone else's country and speak their own language, you know. And I think it's very, I respect it very much that you invite someone from another country and sit here and listen in their language. And the countryside is very beautiful. I will come again.
Yeah, and he also said, this train, you can't hear it, it's the smoothest train I've ever been on. And it's got television.
I was impressed with the TV.
Okay.
What is the most central message that you use when you recruit?
The best method to recruit young people is for other young people. The best method of marketing, once you've started off being credible as a service, is when other young people are telling other young people. Okay? Because that way they are automatically filtering out the ones that are no good. Because not every young person has the skills and abilities to work with other young people. First law of peer education work. Okay? It's not for everyone. You know, we all have different skills and abilities. Schools. And taking the ones that are in the service. So for example, the young people that go to have counselling or that are already in the services, they're perfect young people to use. We've used many methods over the years. Basically, use every method you can. That's what I would say.
One thing I'd add is your agency has to have a good reputation. Mm. You know, that thing about selling a brand is really important. If the brand goes do-gooders, the brand goes, they're going to mess around with my life, then it don't matter what you do, you ain't going to recruit anyone. So you've got to build the brand. And it's long, and it's slow, and it's hard. And if I was telling someone how to start now, from nothing, I don't know how you get your first one or two. Once you've got your first few, it becomes easy. But I can't remember how we got our first one or two.
But also, it's also about having something to offer. Okay, so it's a win-win situation. Yeah. So, are you providing training courses? Are you giving, you know, other support in other areas? What are you actually offering? So you need to know what you're offering those young people before you're recruiting.
And are they going to come in and end up with a smile on their face?
Absolutely. Thank you.
What new trends are reaching
the UK? What new trends?
Yeah.
Okay. Different scenes in the UK. We're seeing an interesting thing happen. In schools there's a lot of cocaine use. The most newest recent thing, I'll say a couple of years old, is ketamine. Those of you that heard of ketamine. Ketamine is legal in the UK, you know, so you can get it quite easily. You know, many people go to India. India, you can buy anything from the pharmacist. And it's because it's legal, it's quite easy to bring into the country. Very powerful drug. Those of you that have taken it might know that it's a very powerful drug, so you get a lot of effects. And there's a lot of, nowadays in the UK, there's not people that use heroin, there's not people who use crack, everyone uses everything, you know? So there's a lot of poly drug, a lot of mixing. So mixing ketamine, speed, mixing crack and speed and stuff like that.
And another one that's coming up now is what they call legal highs. There are internet companies that sell things like Salvia. You heard of Salvia? You know, that's becoming a big thing now because they can't arrest you for it. You know, you get an hour of hallucinations and no one can do you for it. So, I think that's for maybe a year or two until they make it illegal. That'll be a big thing.
Thank you.
And maybe we should also inform, if and don't everybody know it, that you'll spend your own...
We're here for the evening. Yeah. So if there's anything that you want to ask...
Keep up on your thoughts.
Yes. Yeah. We're around.
We were thinking about this idea about the system-oriented or network-oriented work with children. You talk about that you actually, even though you're non-governmental, you manage to get people from school, from house, mm-hmm. so forth coming to you. That's incredible. But what about also parents and the social system around these kids? If you only, it's very easy to say, oh, just forget the past, but these will never forget the blood. Mother or
other. Oh, absolutely, and certainly that statement.
Shouldn't do it.
No, no, no.
You don't know
no.
how thin yeah. that thread is.
Yeah. Or... Yeah, absolutely. First of all, when working with young people, you cannot exclude parents. You have to work with parents. But it's not about working with the parents in the same way as you work with the young people. That's what's key. So what we've done is some very successful programs in primary schools, where what we actually did was, instead of just going in and educating the actual young people, we actually did a session tailored for the teachers at the same time, separately in different rooms, and sessions catered for parents too. Now, we also had telephone advice support for parents, so there's some of the ways that we've worked with parents.
Another thing we do is actually... In Birmingham, where our focus is treatment predominantly, what we have is an agency that works with parents predominantly, and we pair up. We don't share information about the child with the parents or from the parents to the child unless they agree to it. But we both work together and the workers coordinate across the two. But at the end of the day, it's always difficult. And it's always a difficult decision because on the one hand, you want... If parents are supportive, they're the best thing to work with and work with a young person. But sometimes, they're the problem. You know, I worked with a kid and I have a picture, still have a picture, of her at her family Christmas. And there was her father and her mother sat around the table, just completely zonked. And a mountain of drugs on the table. And there was her rolling up a spliff, you know. And there was heroin, there was cocaine, everything. Just everywhere. Now, the young person was the most important. And it would take a lot longer to change the parents. So, I don't know whether that answers it. It's more complicated and perhaps we could talk about it afterwards. But
The welfare of the child is paramount, but part of that is about making sure that ultimately you can put them back into the family or you can work with the family as a whole. That's generally the message. Thank you.
First, I think this is very interesting. It's fun to listen to you. I'm from an organization called Youth Against Drugs, and we are a democratic autonomous organization governed by activists and youth. The medium age is 19-20 in the board. But I'm just thinking, you said so-called hard drugs, soft drugs. My opinion, it's a misleading diversion. So I just want to hear your opinion about that, and the extension of that question. What do you think about decriminalization?
Can I go first?
Yeah, we'll go.
I'll do it quickly. Yeah. I'll do it because we'll probably have different views. One of the things about our organisation is when it comes to decriminalisation, everyone has their own views. The organisation has no view whatsoever. We're not interested in the law. That's for government. That's, you know, we're interested in preventing harm coming to young people. I think that anything that you take can be a problem. We've worked with kids who've been spending £200 a week on cannabis, who couldn't stop taking cannabis, who would steal to use cannabis. And we were being told that cannabis isn't addictive. Well, you know, it must be a different definition of addiction that people are using. To my mind, if gambling can be addictive, if sex can be addictive, what is the magic about cannabis that cannabis can't be addictive? Anything can be addictive. Some things, it's easier to get addicted to quicker. That's the only distinction as far as I'm concerned. If you're looking at hard and soft, then you're looking at how quickly is that harm likely to occur. I don't think there is a distinction to hard and soft, but heroin, you overdose, you can be dead tomorrow. With cannabis, it's going to take maybe 20, 30 years to screw your lungs before it's going to kill you. You're still dead. With nicotine, it takes about the same length of time. I stopped last year. I started again today, smoking. I'm going to have to stop again quickly because otherwise I'll be dead and I'm older. I don't think that the terms hard and soft really mean anything. There are substances and there are the way that people use them, and sometimes people use them in ways that cause more danger than others.
Yeah. Much the same, but this is the thing that, you know, I don't believe in those kind of definitions either. I've actually run those courses that I talked about. I was a tutor in this program at the local college, and I also used to do a session in the 6-month course around sugar, okay? And the effects of sugar.
The ultra soft drugs.
Absolutely, I mean, sugar, and when I lay out the effects of sugar, and in fact I disguise it as another drug, everyone's like, okay, well, what drug is this? I mean, this looks like a powerful drug, yeah, sugar. Yeah. So, I don't believe in those definitions, I just think it's about the outcome. What do we want to do? We want to make this world a better place, don't we? Is that what it's all about? We want a better place for our children, and for their children.
Quick one on the I don't want to see crack on sale at the coalition. Because I think it's too damn dangerous to do that. But I have real difficulty in explaining why I'm not saying that this shouldn't be on sale at the corner shop. And it's because I like these far too much, and I never really got into crack.
Thank you.
Are you in the real danger when you're out in the way forest having a war around this stuff?
I'll answer it quickly. At the raves, no. However, at the end of the kind of scene, at the end of the time, you know, now raves are not really popular in the UK, really. Most of the time people go to clubs now. But towards the end of that era, the music started changing. And you can map out different types of drugs and different types of music and different trends and things, and I'm sure you know, you've seen that. And we see the introduction of some, you know, like jungle music and stuff like that, and then we see crack started going to the raves, and then from when crack was starting going to the raves, it became a dangerous environment, because then there was guns. We've had workers that have had shotguns held up to them at the traffic lights, whilst they've been in their car. So there's always danger. The more impact you're making, the more successful you are, the more in danger you'll be. Because drugs, is it the first money making industry in the world now? Or is it the second?
Second.
Drugs are the second money making industry in the world. Second to arms, isn't it?
Yeah.
Arms first, then drugs make the next amount.
And then oil.
And corn.
And
Porn, sexual,
really? Is that what's coming up with it? Wow, I'm going to see you
saying the name. Don't wish I think. We don't come have it in April.
No, of course. No, we don't have it.
Yeah.
So we have been in danger, and there are dangers. We're here.
But
you can ask us how still be smart.
You're in just as much danger in a treatment centre as you are out on the street now. We've had people bring guns into the treatment centre.
Thank you.
You have quite a success in rather heavy areas, and still you're with cutting the budget.
The money.
Do you have a plan or strategy in sort of lobbying or use the youth or parents groups as pressure on the politicians? Achieve more support?
Using youth and parents groups, probably not. Because you always find another set of parents groups that would say the opposite. You just fight the world lobbies. I think that the answer is, if government says, well, you know, we're not going to fund this kind of work, the answer is to find the money somewhere else. And that's why I think that the idea of doing things like the record label and branching out and stuff like that, you know, to start creating the money that way. We still want to get most of the money from government, but in those places where they won't do it, then we'll find different ones. Just find a different place to get the money. We'll stop short of robbing banks. Or dealing. We won't deal.
We just want to tell you that he was very happy to interview. He was very, very, very nice.
Oh, thank you. I tell you what, it's been a pleasure.